Greetings, you far-out freaks, you stone songbirds. Yes, 1970. Far out, man. So, 1970. It was a very big year of change for me. I didn't know him then. Who is he anyway? So anyway, 1970, the first 7 months of the year, I was travelling away with the Rainbow People, and we went to the Northeast, we went to Belfast, we went to Switzerland, went back to the Northeast, and then we spent 2 months in Germany and went to Italy as well. And then we came back, and our last gig was in August at Blackpool ABC Theatre, and that was when they dropped the bombshell that we were breaking up. And I've been with them for 3 years since I was 15. But we hadn't been paid hardly for the last year, hardly had any money at all. And we're all skin, and the wives were all threatening to leave them, so we broke up.
What about my 37B? What about me?
Well, I'll get on to you in a minute, right?
All right.
I'll just tell him what happened.
Okay.
About the song and everything. So what happened was, I went home, and the agency wanted me to carry on with another band, and my parents said no. They said, you've got to get a job. And you used to listen to your parents in those days, not like our kids do. And so Will Frey, who was the band leader at the Locarno, had told me, if ever you wanted a job, come to me, come to me. So I went down to Locarno and saw Will, and he gave me a job. And there was me with Julie Thursday. And I knew her vaguely before that, but when I worked with her, we got on really well. We were like sisters. And she's still a great friend of mine now. But I had 9 months of real happiness with that band because everybody got on well. And then at the end of 9 months, it was then 1971, Wilf got transferred back to Newcastle, where he came from. And he wanted us all to go with him. And I didn't want to go and live there because I've worked in the Northeast a lot and it's too far away from, you know, everything I had was down in the West Country. But I did agree to go up for 6 weeks and get him started until he got another singer. And then I came back after 6 weeks and Eddie had offered me a job at the Grand Spa Hotel, which is where I met him. But he wasn't in the band yet.
Him? Not till 71?
No. This is 71. I'm in 71 now. And
it's all about 70, not 71?
No, I know, but I'm trying to explain about this song, you know.
Okay.
So I joined the band and Eddie King, the band leader, he played me this song.
Hi, Eddie.
Hi, Eddie. Yeah, and his horses and all that. He played me this song, and I'd never heard it before. And it was by The Fifth Dimension, which was one of my favourite bands. Marilyn McCoo, great singer, and Jimmy Webb, great writer. But it wasn't written by Jimmy Webb. It was written by Burt Bacharach and Hal David for somebody else, for an artist called Keely Smith. And it never took off. And the reason Fifth Dimension did this song was that their sound man, Bones Howe, found it somewhere.
Bones.
In,
yeah. We're the Bones in the band.
In the record company, and played it to them and they liked it. And they released it as a single. It got to number 2 in the Billboard charts in 1970. And it must have got over to us the year after because Eddie'd got hold of it and I learned it. And when he joined the band, I was singing it. And that was December 71. And we were going out with each other for a few weeks and then we broke up. So I got a job in Italy and he did all the arrangements for me. And this song was one of the ones that he arranged for me to do in cabaret in Italy, in Spain, where I went. And it's an absolutely beautiful song. What were you going to say about you anyway?
I was going to say in 1970 I was still with Aardvark and the Aardvark album came out, and then I ended up with Root and Jenny Jackson, and we had a bass player called Bones, and then I ended up in Portsmouth because I couldn't stand London any longer, and that was about it really. Yeah. That's it, end of my story.
So this song was based on when Burt Bacharach was married to Angie Dickinson, policewoman, and they were in London promoting What's New Pussycat, and they had a flat, and for some reason he said, we're moving. And she said, his wife said, Angie Dickinson, oh, well, that's good. That would be one less bell to answer. And they thought, oh, cue for a song.
Can I just say something about the songwriters? How the heck did Hal David get away with one less egg to fry without it sounding silly?
He was advertising for the egg marketing book.
Yeah, I know. And I just want to say something about Burt Bacharach's middle bits, because they really—they always impress.
Mention my middle bits. Yeah, carry on.
They always impressed me because he managed to modulate into completely unrelated keys from the original, and somehow get back to the original key without it sounding awkward. He did it in Alfie. He did it with House Is Not a Home. Yeah. You know, I don't know. He's just a genius for it. You know.
Like here this I one, am. It starts, that's another one I
yeah,
see.
It
here.
Starts off in here D, and then all of a sudden he's in E flat, which is no about as far away. Well, it's only a semitone away, but harmonically it's nowhere near it, you know.
As long as he's in E flat and not somebody else's flat, I suppose.
Yeah,
right,
okay, and the technical stuff.
So anyway, this song is called One Less Bell to Answer, and the only thing I got to say is ding dong. Ciao. Mm.
Ciao.
One less bell to answer, one less egg to fry, one less man to pick up after. I should be happy, but all I do is cry. I should be happy.
Did he go?
I only know that since he left, my life's so empty. Though I try to forget, it just can't be done. Each time the doorbell rings, I still run. I don't know how in the world to stop thinking of him, 'cause I still love him so. I end each day the way I start out, crying my heart out. Well, I've got one less man to pick up after. No more laughter, no more love. Since he went away. Tell me, please, why did he go? Where did he go?